Room, room, trees. That was my segue from the thumbnail to the rest of the episode. How did I do? Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to talk about a triple of G1 improvements that will make your applications simpler to manage and faster to execute. We'll go from already integrated to barely proposed and top it off with a little ZGC update. But first, a little garbage collection primer. Skip to this timestamp if you don't need one. Ready? Then let's dive right in. The ideal garbage collector requires neither extra memory nor CPU time and never pauses the application, leading to maximal throughput and optimal latency. Funnily enough, such a collector even exists, Epsilon GC. The only downside is that it never frees memory and the application just crashes if it runs out. So probably better used for benchmarking than in production. All GCs that don't crash your application need to make trade-offs, most notably between footprint, throughput, and latency. Parallel GC sits on the throughput end of things. It does almost all of its work during pause times, which can make them very long and thus latency very bad, but reduces footprint to a minimum and leads to great throughput. Serial GC is also throughput oriented. ZGC, on the other hand, sits on the other end of the spectrum. It does much of its work concurrently with the application, which requires extra memory and CPU time, but leads to guaranteed ultra-low pause times even on massive heaps. G1 sits in the middle of this spectrum, and by doing some work concurrently, but the rest during pause times, it compromises between footprint, latency, and throughput, which makes it the default GC in most environments. More on that later. G1 is a so-called regional garbage collector, meaning it divides the heap into regions and marks each as containing either young or old objects. That allows for a flexible ratio of the two generations that can align with each application's needs. The separation into regions also brings us to the first G1 improvement. When moving objects from one region to another, reference to them must be updated. But G1 doesn't want to scan the whole heap for references to a moved object because that would take too long. So instead it tracks cross-region references in a so-called cart table. To keep that data structure up to date, G1 and the just-in-time compiler inject code fragments into to the heap. This is called a write barrier. That means that when code that runs as part of your application, be it your code, your dependencies, or the JDKs, updates a non-primitive field or array, it ends up executing the write barrier, which means they run in application threads. At the same time, to keep the table performant, G1 is optimizing it in the background, which leads to contention and synchronization with these application threads. As you can imagine, orchestrating all this is also quite complex, and that complexity is directly reflected in the write barriers, which can make them rather slow. And this is where JEP 522 enters the picture. It introduces a second cart table so that application threads can work with one and the G1 optimizer threads with another, plus a mechanism for swapping and reconciling them. That reduces contention and the need for synchronization and also simplifies the write barriers. According to the JEP, that simplification alone leads to throughput gains of up to 5% across the board, with applications that heavily modify object reference fields further benefiting from the reduced contention and seeing improvements of up to 15%. Pause times and thus latencies decrease slightly. JEP 522 is already integrated into JDK 26 and available in the early access builds. Links to that, as well as to everything else I mentioned in this episode, in the description. G1 is often described as Java's default garbage collector, but that's not actually true. You see, Java is just a standard, and its governing body, the JCP, doesn't recognize the concept of a default garbage collector. Be gone, evil spirit! Be gone! What I meant to say is that if no command line option chooses a specific GC, the runtime will often, but not always, default to G1. On single CPU machines with less than a bit under 2 gigs of memory, it picks serial GC instead because in that kind of environment, it used to have significant advantages in throughput and footprint. Note the past tense though. Over the last couple of releases, G1's footprint has come down, and recent work, particularly the simpler write barriers we just discussed, has brought its throughput close to serial GCs in these constrained environments. So the two collectors are now competitive on these two metrics, but G1's maximum latencies have always been better than serials. So JEP 523 proposes to always default to G1, regardless of environment, which will improve maximum latencies in many situations where serial GC used to be selected, and will also make it easier to understand and reason about the JVM's behavior. It also reduces the number of topics in which people like me can, well, actually you, which is somewhat annoying to me personally, but probably a plus for the wider community. And don't worry if serial GC performs better than G1 in your environment. There are no plans to remove it, and you can still select it explicitly with the simple --xx:+use serial GC. JEP523 is not yet proposed to target a release. The minimum and maximum heap size can be configured with the options -XMS and -XMX respectively. Determining the best values isn't easy though. The application's memory requirements can change throughout its runtime. The JVM's own variable memory requirements need to be factored in. Other applications may require memory, and so does the operating system, for example, to populate file caches. Take all this together and it becomes obvious that determining heap size is no simple task.
Oh no, can't someone else do it?
The garbage man can!
Exactly, let the garbage collector determine its own minimum and maximum heap size. And there's a JEP draft that proposes just that for G1. It would automatically and dynamically size its heap anywhere between 4 megabytes or XMS, whatever is higher, and close to all of the available memory or XMX, whatever is lower. So if you know your exact heap size needs, set XMS and XMX to exactly that. But otherwise, you're encouraged to omit both values and let G1 choose. It will do so by considering a multitude of factors. The total memory, whether compressed OOPs are enabled, which limits the heap to 32 gigs, the environment's pressure, the... Oh, shit! The wind tries to take the camera. And there's a steep drop right there. Okay, starting over. It will do so by considering a multitude of factors. The total memory, whether compressed OOPs are enabled, which limits the heap to 32 gigs, the environment's memory pressure, the application's allocation rate with a specific eye on surges, the JVM's internal native memory usage, the GC's CPU overhead, the G1 options GC time ratio and G1 GC intensity, the latter of which is new, and probably more. To balance all these factors, G1 will shrink and expand the heap as needed. If you're interested in more details on how it does that, check out the JEP. But keep in mind that it's still a draft, which means it's very early days for this feature and lots may still change. It would be remiss of me not to at least mention that there's a similar JEP proposing automatic heap sizing for ZGC. Love it. Taking all this together, we're looking at a future where a big chunk of Java applications will have optimal GC behavior without any command line flex. And another big chunk will have likewise optimal behavior by just selecting ZGC. What a time to be alive. And that's it for today on the Inside Java Newscast. I see you again in 2 weeks for the 100th episode. Wow. I'm not sure yet how to celebrate that. If you have any ideas, let me know in the comments. I see you then. So long.